Kim's Convenience is about a convenience store in Regent Park that's owned by Mr. and Mrs. Kim.
What?
It's a comedic drama about Koreans in Toronto.
When I was your age, I go to church, find the Jesus, find cool Christian Korean boy, and we hook around.
My initial inspiration to write Kim's Convenience was to hire myself as an actor.
Write what you know, so Korean. All right, convenience stores.
Ince Choi, the creator, was a student here. He in fact completed writing the play while a student in the Soul Pepper Academy. And he came to me and he said, there's this play contest at the Fringe, and if you send your play and it gets it, you get a free berth in the Fringe. We said, yeah, go for it.
When we were first rehearsing it, the play for the Fringe, we couldn't stop laughing. Like, I don't think we did a single run through before we were on stage where somebody didn't corpse.
Zane's had been struggling with an ending for so long in the play, and then finally we'd been started rehearsing the play for the Fringe, and he said, hey Paul, I think I got the ending. And we were both crying by the end of it. It's like, that's the ending, that's it. You know, because it is, it's my family story.
There were things that, in the play, that were so Korean, you know, you'd sort of jump out of your skin going, oh my God, my mom does the same thing.
There was something about the audience the first time we saw it at the Fringe that happened again and again and again, and it was this uproarious laughter.
It created a kind of cultural curiosity to be in that audience, and a kind of energy of, my goodness, we have a lot to learn from each other in terms of celebrating our life as Canadians.
There was something about the community galvanized by this particular story.
At the end of the very first performance at the Fringe Festival, the lights go down, and I thought in my head that it sucked. Like, I thought it was a failure. Oh no, they don't like it. And then the lights came on, and everyone stood up to their feet to enormous applause. And then I knew, it's not bad.
I don't think we knew how big it was until we had our first audience. It was completely packed, and then the second audience was completely packed, and there were lineups around the block, and that's when we realized, okay, oh my God, this has got not just legs, this has got like turbine power, it's going somewhere. We didn't know where.
With this one, 2 weeks into the run, we went, we have to find five more
weeks.
We had
no tickets left.
Like, it just went bam, it exploded.
I'd seen the play maybe 3 or 4 years ago, and I loved it. I thought it was great, and I laughed, and I cried. I don't know, maybe a year and a half later, I got a call from my agent saying, do you want to meet with them? They're meeting with showrunners and writers, and I said, yeah, I'd love to. I love the play. I would love to have a chance to work on it.
And then we spent time together talking and just kind of like expanding the world of the play and seeing what would work in TV.
Ince himself was very open to exploring the world and changing or modifying it. He's a very open, collaborative artist.
When Kim's Convenience hits, I hope that, and I know a lot of kids will see it and go, whoa, that guy looks like me. They are amazing. She is hilarious. Maybe I could do that too. I'm part of this television world in Canada now.
We have diversity on our screens for the first time. In a long time, I think, where a non-white Caucasian family is sort of the center focus, and we were hoping to portray it as a real family. But not only that, I think audiences will sort of come to love the Kim family and realize that, hey, you know what? They're not that much different than our family. Our families have the same struggles.
I love that the show brings together an incredibly diverse cast in scenes that happen, interactions that happen in Toronto all the time, but never make it onto TV.